Good morning, everybody, and welcome to WBCR Radio. You are listening to 99 on the line here, and I am your host, Jonas Jackson. This is my first ever show here on the radio, so I'm excited and nervous at the same time, but just bear with me. I just want to give all the glory and the honor to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, first of all, for allowing me another day of life and just to give me the opportunity here to be on the radio show here at Brooklyn College. And let's get it rolling. All right, so what a game last night at Super Bowl 52 between the Philadelphia Eagles and the New England Patriots. It was just, personally for me, I believe I wanted the Eagles to win, but it's just so hard to bet against Tom Brady and the Patriots of the dynasty they've created, and I wasn't going to bet against them. I chose Philly and the Patriots to get to the Super Bowl, but I thought ultimately that the Patriots will come out with a win. And I got to give the Philadelphia Eagles credit. They proved all of us wrong, or a lot of us wrong. And even since the beginning of the playoffs, I could speak for myself. I had counted them out. They lost Carson Wentz, one of the up-and-coming superstar quarterbacks that's in this league in the NFL. And I thought that it was a big blow, but Nick Foles, he got the job done, which was just in a fantastic game where him and Tom Brady had great games. It was just a quarterback duel throughout the game. And, oh, man, I was watching the game. It was just so many different plays that could be decided as the turning points for each game. One of the first things I wrote was the interception by New England at the 5-yard line in New England's territory. And it was during the 5-minute mark during the second quarter where Philadelphia, I believe, was up 12-6. And if that play is incomplete, or if Alshon Jeffrey, he had a chance, he grabbed it with one hand, but ultimately he couldn't hold it down. And he tapped it back up and it was intercepted. But that was just a huge turnaround play for the New England Patriots, who could have saw themselves down 19-6 if Philly was able to convert on that play or just get down the field and score and potentially score a touchdown. And it was just, if you just look at it, Tom Brady threw for 505 yards, 3 touchdowns, and he had the one forced fumble that, you know, was probably the biggest play of the game. And wow, man, if anyone would have told me Tom Brady would throw for 500 plus yards, 3 touchdowns, and the team only punted once, man, I'm taking the Patriots every time you tell me that. It was no way I would have thought that the Philadelphia Eagles would be able to win that game. I thought it would be a great game. I didn't expect it to be this high of a scoring game. I expected Philadelphia's defense, you know, to control the games in a way that it will cause it to be a low-scoring game, but I was wrong, and probably a lot of us were. But congratulations to all the Philadelphia Eagles fans. It is their first Super Bowl win, and I believe it's been since 1960 that they've actually had a football championship there. I'm not sure what it was called back then, but this, nonetheless, is the first Super Bowl win for the Philadelphia Eagles. And just going back to the game, Doug Peterson, what a great job he did. He made a lot of gutsy calls in that game. It was a couple of fourth downs and short that he decided to go for it. And he trusted, you got to give him credit, he trusted his quarterback, Nick Foles, and he trusted the whole team and that whole offense to perform in the biggest stage of the game, of the football game. And it was fourth and one, and he decided to, it was first down with 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter. And he decided to go for the fourth down. And Nick Foles completed a pass to their tight end, Zach Ertz, who had a phenomenal game, 7 catches, 57 yards, and a touchdown. And that gave them the first down with 5 minutes left. And they eventually will go on to score a touchdown. Same thing, Foles to Ertz for a touchdown catch on 3rd and 7 to give Philadelphia a 38-33 lead. And I have a feeling in the sports world is going to be a lot of people talking about whether or not if that was a catch when Nick Foles, like I said, on 3rd and 7, Nick Foles threw a short slant pass to Zach Ertz, Philadelphia Eagles tight end. And it looked like, to me personally, I believe it was a catch. He caught the ball. He took about 3 or 4 steps, which showed that he had possession of the ball, and he was a runner then. And he dived for the touchdown. The ball hit the ground a little bit. He fumbled it up out of his hands, and then he grabbed it back. It's just like if you could imagine probably a glass cup slipping out of your hands up in the air, and then you go and grab it and bring it back home to your chest. It was just like that. That's what Ertz did. And a lot of people, I think, will agree with me that that was a catch. And hopefully going into the next season, the NFL could actually get the rules right with the no catch or catch rules. But moving on, we're going to stay with football. Last week, the Kansas City Chiefs decided to move on from Alex Smith, and they traded him to the Washington Redskins in my New York Giants division. So that's definitely going to be interesting to see how that all works out. The Chiefs will receive a 3rd-round pick and an undisclosed player that hasn't been named yet. And according to reports, Smith is going to sign a 4-year extension with the Redskins worth $94 million, $70 million guaranteed. So they definitely feel that Alex Smith is worth trading for, and they plan to keep him there for long term. And that obviously, we'll all expect that the team is going to end their pursuit of re-signing Kirk Cousins, who's been with them for the last several years. And, you know, everything with the drama of him, of the franchise, continue to franchise tag him. And for those of you who do not know what a franchise tag is, it's basically when a player on your franchise, when a player in the franchise can't agree to terms to a long-term contract, the franchise is allowed to put what is called a franchise tag on the player, which will automatically give the player a 1-year deal at a very high salary. And I'm not sure what goes into it, but usually it'll be something like probably a year and $12 million, a year or $18 million. It's just a way for a franchise and a player to get things straight short term if they can't agree on something. But moving on, if for me, when I saw that trade, is how does this affect the Redskins and the NFC North? And to me, it's big time, because Alex Smith, he's proven he might not be a Super Bowl quarterback, but he definitely can lead a team to the playoffs with the right weapons. Kansas City was able to make the playoffs this year, and they got knocked out early. But Alex Smith is a pretty much one of the, I would say, top 15 quarterbacks in the NFL. And what once was a weak NFC North is now looking to be one of the best divisions in the NFL. You got the New York Giants, who I'll be talking about a little bit later. You have the Philadelphia Eagles, who just won the Super Bowl. And now you have the Washington Redskins, who've got their long-term solution at quarterback now, and, you know, can move on and show some type of stability. And we'll see how that plays out. And you still got the Dallas Cowboys with Dak Prescott and Zach Elliott and them boys. They need to fix the defense. But nonetheless, they still are a threat in the NFC North. So, all right, I'm going to move along. I think it's going to be tough. The NFC North is going to be tough. I think it's going to be one of the best divisions next year. But we'll see how it all plays out. All right. Moving on, we're going to head to, it was a Bleacher Report talking about the New York Giants quarterback Eli Manning is quote unquote fine if the Giants choose to draft the quarterback in this year's NFL draft, stating, and I quote, "I know how old I am." So if I'm the New York Giants, this is definitely something I'm happy to hear about, and it's encouraging statements from Eli Manning, who's expressed his willingness to stay with the team whether they draft the quarterback or not. He wants to be a New York Giant. He's been a New York Giant all his career, and you know, with everything about Ben McAdoo deciding to bench him and all the controversy around that and him possibly leaving, I think he's pretty much shutting that down and making it known to us that he wants to be a Giant. He wants to retire Giant, and he's willing to compete for the starting quarterback job. And we have I say we because I'm a New York Giants fan. I like to include myself a lot, but the New York Giants have Brandon Webb, who's they drafted, I believe, in the third or fourth round a couple years ago. And if I'm the Giants, let Eli compete with him. I honestly do not think the Giants should draft a quarterback. I still think Eli Manning could get it done. He this year he threw 19 touchdowns, 13 interceptions. Not a great TD ratio, but the team's offensive line was just so dreadful this year that, I mean, you can't ask anybody to really do much better than that. It is extremely difficult to be able to perform at a high level and perform efficiently when you're constantly under duress by the defense, the other opposing team's defense, and you only have about 3 or 4 seconds to get the ball out of your hands to make something happen. And with his top weapon, Odell Beckham Jr., going down midway through the season, and Sterling Shepard going down back and forth, being healthy and hurt, and Brandon Marshall also, who a lot of us Giants fans expected to be a great second or third option on this team to do big things, but he got hurt as well. And it was just a injury-plagued season for the New York Giants. And unlike last year, the defense wasn't able to cover for the offensive line. The defense last year was great. They were one of the best NFL defenses in the league. But this year, I mean, it's tough when you don't have a good offensive line, at least a decent offensive line. It's going to be very difficult for you to win any games, especially against the best teams in the NFL. And also, before I move on, general manager Dave Gettleman and head coach Pat Shurmur have both expressed their support for Eli as the starting quarterback going into next season. So as far as the front office and the head coach, they seem to have their faith in Eli and believe he can still perform at a high enough level to be able to help this New York Football Giants team to make another Super Bowl run. But moving on, we're going to head to my New York Knicks. Another disappointing season, but I guess it's expected with the Carmelo trade to OKC. I won't lie. I am a OKC fan too now, because I am a Melo fan as well. So don't scrutinize me or anything, but I love me some Carmelo Anthony. He's a great player. I love his boldness to come to New York City and try to win a championship. Unfortunately, it couldn't work out. And Phil Jackson had a big reason to do with that, with sabotaging this franchise. But nonetheless, the New York Knicks, and it's been reports that the New York Knicks and Joakim Noah have mutually agreed to remain apart until further notice. Now, about last week or a week or so, Noah and head coach, the New York Knicks head coach Jeff Hornacek, got into a heated discussion during practice, and ever since then, the team and Noah have decided that it's best for them to remain apart. And if you just think about it, it's been a disappointing tenure here with the Knicks. If you're Joakim Noah, who's a native New Yorker, and I believe he was born and raised in Hell's Kitchen, New York. But Noah signed a 4-year, $72 million deal in the summer of 2016 under Phil Jackson's tenure, who, thank God, is no longer here. And we are not in the hands of Scott Perry, and the Knicks are in the hands of Scott Perry and Steve Mills now. But he is owed, Joakim Noah is owed $18.5 million next year. And then the year after that, he's going to make $19.3 million if the Knicks can't find a trading partner to move him and get that horrendous contract out of the franchise salary cap. But I highly doubt that's going to happen. The Knicks have nothing's been brewing between Knicks and other NBA teams to get him out of there. And I've heard that it was another report in the same report, in Bleacher Report. It said that they'll owe him $7.5 million annually for the next 5 years if the New York Knicks do decide that it's best to waive him and just let him become, I guess, he would become a free agent. And Noah's 32, late in his career now. He was just averaging 4.6 points and about eight rebounds as a Knick. And I got to be honest, that is terrible. You don't stink. No worse than that. About 5 points and eight rebounds, and you're going to make $18 million next year. I know that has to be one of the worst contracts ever to be made, but I mean, I don't think anybody, at least me, I didn't expect this to happen. I thought Noah would be a great piece to this team, you know, to if not be one of the like top 10 centers in the league, at least be a pivotal part of the New York Knicks franchise going forward and help mentoring Porzingis and just helping the team, you know, create a successful culture. But so far, it doesn't look like that's not going to happen. And we'll see moving forward what the Knicks decide to do that's best for their franchise. Personally, I think maybe just waiving him and, you know, 7.5 million for the next year is a lot of money. But I think it would be best if they could just mutually, like they've already done, they mutually agreed to be apart. I think it's just time to permanently separate themselves and just decide to waive him and move on. And lastly, before I didn't quite get to the summary of the show, half the segment is going to be sports, where I'll be discussing predominantly basketball, baseball, and football, and other hot topics around the sports world, but predominantly those three sports I'll be discussing for the first 30 minutes of the show. And I apologize for the lateness. MTA, man, I got out of my house at least by like 9:15. I expected it to be by 10:30, but I just got here at 11 o'clock. You know, if you're a New Yorker, you know MTA and them delays, those are killers. And I actually had to use the bathroom, so that also helped me up as well. I mean, it was a lot of people looking at me weird because I was stomping while I was listening to my music to keep myself occupied. So I wouldn't use the bathroom myself. But anyways, let me stay on track here. Half the sports is going to be about sports. And for all of you that are listening, do not know me, I am a Christian. I love Jesus, and I mentioned him early in the show. The other half is going to be about Christianity and about religion. So I'm going to be discussing that for the last 20 or 30 minutes of this show today. But my last sports topic is LeBron shuts down rumors of possibly joining the Golden State Warriors this summer. Quote unquote, LeBron said it's nonsense and it's a non-story. And he also mentioned how if anything that the media says doesn't come out of his voice, if you don't hear him say it, then it's definitely not true. And I mean, if you're an NBA fan and if you thought that LeBron was actually going to go to the Golden State Warriors, I mean, I don't know what to tell you. That would be absolutely ridiculous, and it would be just a soft and weak move for LeBron, who's still the best player in this league, for him to go to the team that's been dominating the league for the past 3 or 4 years. That's just absolutely unheard of, and it doesn't get no worse than that. I mean, KD, he went to the team that beat him, but if LeBron went to Golden State, that would be way worse. And I think that's just disrespectful to him and his legacy for people to actually, I mean, people are going to entertain the hype, but if you actually believe that LeBron was going to go to Golden State, I don't know what kind of drink you had the day before, but it wasn't something to keep you sober, because LeBron, as he already mentioned and stated last week, he is not going to go to Golden State. There's a lot of speculation that he'll be going to the Los Angeles Lakers to join Lonzo Ball and the crew and be with a young team. But I don't know. We'll see. It's not looking good right now for the Cleveland Cavaliers. They've been on a bad losing streak. They've been on and off and can't seem to get things going and having problems in the locker room. But nonetheless, LeBron is a four-time MVP and a three-time MVP, and he's done it before where he's led his team and just willed them to the finals. But we'll see what happens. We're going to take a quick break right now. I'll be back, and I'll be talking about in my next segment about the reason why I'm going to talk about Jesus. You know, a lot of people may wonder why us Christians are so faithful in our relationship with God. And I'll explain a little bit about that, and I'll explain to you why I think accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior is the best decision you'll ever make in your life. So tune in to that. I'll be back after this short break. Enjoy the music. I am going to play some gospel music just to get everyone in the mood to let's talk Jesus, okay? All right.
Cheers.
that I've done can tear me away from you. Nothing that I've said can tear me away from you. Oh, your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out, never runs out on me. Nothing, nothing. Can you lift your hand high, say I love you, Jesus, I love you. Yes, I love you because you first loved me. Sing it one more time, I love you. Welcome back to 99 on the Line. Again, you are listening to this. Welcome back to. I'm sorry, y'all. Welcome back to 99 on the Line. I'm your host, Jonas Jackson, and you are listening to WBCR Radio here at Brooklyn College. We are into the next segment of my show, and we're going to be discussing why do we need Jesus. Now, if you're just tuning in, I've discussed that half of the show is going to be about sports, and the other half will be all about Jesus. I am Christian, I am saved, and I do love the Lord. And to start off of why do we need Jesus is, I'm just going to start with a lot of people probably have heard before, which is John 3:16-17. And I'm going to just pull it up on my phone, the scripture, to make sure I say it correctly. I do remember it sometimes, but the word of the Lord says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God not sent his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Now, a lot of people know about Adam and Eve and how Satan came in as a snake. And one of the things that I've learned about what the Bible speaks of Satan and the snake is one of the most cunning animals. And the Satan himself, that's a characteristic. One of the main characteristics is that he's so cunning. He's so slick and tricky. And at the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve, he tricked them to disobey God and to eat the apple from the tree of life, which is something that God, which I believe was the one thing that God told them not to do. And for that reason that they bit the apple, first Eve and then Adam, that they were in the transgressions. And from then on, we were in sin. And it wasn't just Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve represents humanity. And if that was on one of us, if it was another male or female, the same thing would have happened. Adam and Eve represent mankind. And for that reason, God sent his only son, his only begotten son, to the world so he could show us the way. Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except by me. So Jesus came here on earth to show us the way and how to live holy and how to please God. And in doing so, he was persecuted for saying that he was the Son of God. And even in our society today, a lot of people don't want to hear the truth. They just want to believe in their own truth. And including myself, some of us a lot like to believe in our own truths. But ultimately, I've decided that I'm going to believe in Jesus's truth, because he said he is the way, the truth, and the life. And he died on the cross for our sins. He went on Calvary. He was the ultimate and perfect sacrifice for our sins. And even though he was perfect, even though he didn't deserve to be crucified, he didn't deserve to go through all of that punishment. They if you never heard, they mocked him, they spat in Jesus's face, they put because he claimed that he was the Son of God, and he is the Son of God, and the Roman soldiers put thorns on his head, 72 thorns on his head, and thorns are basically like sharp sticks, and they put it on his head, they mocked him, they spat in his face, they whipped him, and he took all of that because he loved us. And just like in the song I just played, Jesus loves us, and the reason why I love him is because he first loved me. And just like in the 17th verse, it says, "For God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world." Jesus didn't come here to condemn nobody. He didn't come here to put nobody down, but he came here to show us a way that we could still live a happy life, to still live in joy and peace, but without the mind and without the desire to sin. Because ultimately, when it's all said and done, we are going to have to answer for the things that we do in this body. And in the Bible actually says that it is appointed unto man to once die, but after this the judgment. So we also have to, even though I know a lot of us as human beings, we like to, you know, be in control and do what we think is best for us, but God is not just concerned about our well-being in the flesh. When I say flesh, I mean in our human form, but God is also worried about our souls. And after this life that we live here on earth, we are our soul that's deep within. As the Bible says, we had made Adam, he blew the breath of life into Adam, and he became a living soul. So after we live here on earth, whenever that time is, we're going to have to, our soul is going to get out of our body, and we're going to have to go before God. And he's going to decide based on the life we live. He's not just picking and choosing who's going to go to hell, who's going to heaven, but he's going to judge us. And based on our life and the lifestyle we live, whether it was by, based off of whether we live by his word or not, we are going to either go to hell or to heaven. Now, for myself, I choose to live. I want to go to heaven. I want to see my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the one who died for all of us. And that's what it comes down to. And living in this life, we all want to be happy. We want to live a life. And you can find that in Jesus. Jesus said, "Come to me, all that are heavy laden," which means all that have burdens of in this life. We could come across a lot of obstacles and challenges that just become a burden to us, but Jesus said, "Come to me and I will give you rest." So we could find all the things that we need here on this earth. God will be able to supply for us, and that's the thing. And you could give to the poor, you could not curse, you could be a great citizen by societal standards. But if you have not confessed your sins to Christ, asking for forgiveness, you won't have any hope. You won't have a chance. The Bible says that for we must all appear before the judgment again. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he have done, whether it be good or bad. And we're gonna have to answer for that. And we're gonna the whole reason why Jesus came to die on the cross was so that his blood will wash away our sins. So when we go before God in judgment, he won't see us, but he'll see Jesus. Because when you give your life to Christ and just allow him to ask him to come into your heart, into your life and your mind, God will do a new thing in you. And that's what it's about. It's about, we want other people, even including myself as a Christian, I don't want people to see Jonas. I want people to see Jesus, the person that loved everybody, the person that did good, that like I said, that loved everybody. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And Jesus loves us. He was a healer. He had long suffering. He had patience. He was humble. There's a song that's saying, "There is none like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. So there's nobody like Jesus. And I guarantee you, if you just try God, I believe and I know that he will make a way for you. He'll be everything that you absolutely need. He's been everything I need or and can ask for. It's just remarkable of how God's just blessed me. Even on this radio show, I'm able to speak about sports and about Jesus. And I'm just a freshman here. So God is able to make a way if you just give him a chance. A lot of people go to, you know, to drinking, to drugs, whatever the case may be, to other things. But I guarantee you, if you just give God a chance, if you just give Jesus a chance, he will not fail, because God can do anything but fail. And just to move on and to continue this before the show ends, even for the people that claim that they're living a good, happy life and don't need Jesus, if you haven't committed, if you claim that you're happy and, you know, you have all the things that you want, we still have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us have sinned. If you believe that you haven't sinned before, you're just lying, and that's the sin. We've all lied. We all have done something wrong, whether it be like the smallest thing, like I said, like a lie, or whether it be stealing and murder, whatever. But God is, he loves us so much that if we just come to him and yield to him and give our life to Christ, that he'll forgive us all of his sins. That was the whole purpose of why Jesus died on the cross, so that if we come to him, he'll forgive us of our sins. And no matter what we've done or how bad you think what your past has been, the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So when you give your life to Christ, you are a new creature. And that's when, and it's all a process. I'm not a perfect Christian. Nobody's a perfect Christian, but we're all, I can speak for myself. I personally am striving to be the perfect person I can be. And I can only be that if I allow Jesus into my life and allow his supernatural love. That's the thing. A lot of people, you know, we could love, whether it be through intimacy with our spouse or whatever like that. But it takes a supernatural love just to change the person that you are. And it's nothing like the love of God and the love he has for us, being our maker and our creator who's created us. And also in 1 Peter 4:17-18, it talks about how we as Christians scarcely make it into heaven. And scarcely just means hardly, like barely, by the skin of our teeth. We just barely make it in, even as Christians. So if a saved person, whether it be pastor, priest, Christian, Catholic, if we genuinely accept Christ as our Lord and Savior and barely make it in, where does that leave the people who haven't accepted Christ? And if we barely make it in, and if you haven't accepted Christ, that just makes it even scarcer that you have the potential to make it in. But that is not of God's will. His word in the Bible, it says that he does not desire that any shall perish, but that we will all have everlasting life. And that's what God wants for us. We just have to make a conscious choice. He gave us free will. He didn't make us robots. He didn't say, oh, you're going to serve me, you're going to give me all the praise, even though he's worthy of it. And because he's so worthy of it, the Bible even says that the rocks will cry out in our place if we don't praise him. So if we scarcely, we in this life, and time is coming up. A lot of people are, you know, it's one of the things that a lot of Christians and just a topic around the world that a lot of people are talking about, of how all these natural disasters are happening. And these are all prophecies in the Bible. And you could find them in Matthew 24, where Jesus talks about how there'll be rumors of war and disasters, and that'll just be the beginning of it. If you look back in history of World War One, World War Two, that's when every nation, like the Bible described, every nation will be against each other and be fighting. And time is winding up, and I just encourage you to give your life to Christ. I could testify for myself that he is everything that I need. He's blessed me. I've been through a lot even since young, where my appendix exploded. I've gotten hit in the eye with a baseball and had a fracture, or thank God, not a fracture, but a deep contusion on my cheekbone. I've been through a lot, and through it all, Jesus has been there for me and my family. And I just encourage all of you that are listening to just give your life to Christ. Give him a chance. If you tried everything else, just try Jesus. And like I said before, I guarantee you, he'll provide for you. He'll make a way for you. And if you're listening, if you decide you want to give your life to Christ, you could just repeat this sentence prayer with me. And then that'll just be the end of the show. So you could just say, Lord, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I am a sinner. Lord, I believe that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to come down here on earth to die on the cross for my sins. Lord, I believe that your son died on the cross for my sins. Forgive me of all of my sins, oh God. And Lord, come into my heart, come into my life, and come into my mind. Make me whole and make me a new creature, oh God. In Jesus' name. And that's all it takes. That's all it takes, is just to confess your sins and just believe in your heart that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And it might seem hard, but if you just try Jesus, I guarantee, I keep saying it, but it is definitely true. I guarantee you, he'll reveal himself to you, and he'll show you that he's real. And before I end the show, I just got a text from my brother that I gotta play one of his songs, so I'm gonna just pull it up for you right now. My brother, I love you, Ronnijay. I know you're listening right now. I love my family. I thank God for my mom and my father who've raised me ever since I was young in the church. And let me see what song I'm gonna put. But again, I just encourage all of y'all to just give your life to Christ and to accept him as your Lord and Savior. And right quick, I'm just going to play a song that my brother produced and that his my future sister-in-law was featuring and also sung. And I played the bass for it. So I hope you enjoy it. I hope you enjoyed the show. Thank you for bearing with me. This is my first ever show on the radio. Continue to pray for me. I'm gonna get better at this, and I hope y'all all have a blessed day, and God bless. Jesus loves you.
Yes, it is you that came into my life. I'm glad now that I'm saved. My soul can live forever. Yes, it can. Oh, Lord. Yes, it is you that came into my life. I'm glad now that I'm saved. Yes, it is you that came into my life. I'm glad now that I'm saved. My soul can live forever. My soul can live forever. Yeah.
yes, it is you that came into my life. I'm glad now that I'm saved. My soul can live forever.
Yeah.